in the real change, game changer, which is the early intervention and prevention to stop an individual to come into the social care service. And the final bit for me is keeping hold of the lacking, developing them, making sure that they're motivated. Because it's hard. Think about my colleagues causing improvements a funeral march. The only good thing about funerals is there's usually a little buffet at the end of it, depending on whether you go to the kind of funerals I go to. We just need to put a bit of spark in the mix as well, because actually, I've just been at a whole day session with our head teachers about this. What could be better? As an adult, how could you spend your time better than working with children and helping them with their lives? So we need to make sure that we get that right and keep on recruiting to what we need to create, which is a winning team. So there's stuff that's going on that will not have an impact on the Ofsted judgments. It might have a marginal impact, but not the kind of impact we were trying to make on our children and people and our families. So we're doing that as well. And I think that's been done. Thank you all very much for support us. Any questions?
Okay, David.
I did sort of like the fact that you pointed out that the Ofsted was not the sole reason for your assistance in any sideshow, but it's an important one. But knowing you as I do, Paul, I'm not surprised that you said that. I think the concern I've probably got is that there's a weirdness around children's services. The higher the figure goes up, it's not necessarily a negative, because it shows that you're actually doing your job and children are vulnerable and being treated. But in fairness, at what point do you start to say that we're on this sort of curve to success, really? Is that one? And I think you pointed out that most of your staff are on board, and then you might start to sort of fall into the yes, I'm with you, yes, I want to be with you, and those that work somewhere else in the future. That third category, do you already know the numbers of the third category who would no longer be working for you?
Yes, please.
Yes.
We show this slide every time we have a staff engagement event of this person trying to push a boulder up a hill, and we check in and say, where's your boulder? I think, and then once you get to the summit of the kids, there's no kind of moss kind of stuff, isn't it? Depending on what day of the week you catch yourself, it's near the top, but not the top yet. And I think we will get to the point where momentum drives improvement when we've cracked this issue about having the right people in the right place at the right time. So as an example of that, we've got 24, I think it is, team managers. Don't quote me on the numbers here, they're not all permanent. If we had 20 of them, we really would. We wouldn't have to have this conversation. And we probably not. We're halfway there with that. We're lucky, yeah. So we can't wait to go. Do we know the number? Yes, we do.
I wasn't asking. I'll say as long as you know you are.
You said that all staff are required to attend the back to basics training. Is that mandatory or is it optional?
No, it's mandatory.
Okay, so what happens to those staff who don't attend?
It's a slightly convoluted answer to this question, because we've got people coming and going. The amount of back to basics training is continuing to be offered to make sure that everyone can be through the process. We've had a conversation recently about what is the definition of mandatory, and it means that you've got to do it. And we do have some people who think that mandatory means when I can get there. So we haven't done this yet, but there are processes you could use to challenge people around that, which would be something called written warnings about, where we say you must do, it doesn't mean that you've got the option. I don't know the actual figures on who's been through back to basics training, but we can find also need a point you're making that if it's mandatory, you've got to do it. And sometimes people think that mandatory means not for them. The course I'm talking about is the trend I'm talking about, where we've had the conversation about what we do with these 80 people who haven't turned up yet. It's to do with surplus absence management. So we've got 8 people, about 7 people actually, who haven't turned up for training, who don't have the full performance, culture.
That leads on to the follow up question, really. The Ofsted report said, I think if I recall correctly, that the caseloads in Grove weren't particularly high in comparison to other authorities. But one of the problems we've had from anecdotal cases is the number of social workers that any one family will be passed around us, causing confusion, lack of data, lack of recording of the case. So while we're saying that things are stable, are we satisfied that a family is still being supported by the minimum number of changes of personnel?
So there's two parts of the answer. Is that the structure that was in place before actually encouraged cases to transfer to the social workers. There were too many handoffs. So I've done my bit using your bit there. So the integrated front door and this assessment and intervention service is designed to avoid any handoffs unless the child becomes looked after child permanently. So we've really only got one transfer point now in the system. So the structural changes will reduce the experience of the families have been handed on to different people. The change of work due to people going off sick, new people taking on a case, or agency workers coming and going, remains an issue. It's not as acute as it was. But it's still an issue. So some families will be experiencing too many changes of individual social workers. And that's something that we do keep a very close eye on. One thing I would say is, again, the last monitoring letter said that the view of Ofsted was that the social workers they've talked to knew their families well. And that's because they have had more stable relationships with those children and with those families. But it is very much a work in progress. We've still probably got about 30 full-time equivalent social work posts that we need to recruit to. Out of 170. So there's still that risk, isn't there? And if those 30 posts are all covered by agency workers, they don't have to give us a reason notice. One of the problems that we've got around challenge is if you challenge people who don't work for you, they can just get the code card without rationality. And sometimes when you challenge people who do work for you, they become more mad. That is the issue, but that is still an issue for us.
Thank you.
Okay, I've got Chris and then Jill.
Thanks, Nick. Thanks, Paul. You just answered some of my questions. So that it was broken and you're on the way to get that done and you've made quite a lot of progress and getting stable now. Do you think, are we still at the stage now of sticking plasters or are we at the stage now where we can start looking at the early intervention more? Because as we've said previously, we've got more children in care here in the world than in comparison to other. So I'm just wondering what stage we're at so that we can start looking at early intervention to prevent the prevention.
Okay, so we're not into sticking plasters anymore. I've got all these things which are cutting plaster out of the neck, but we're not into that anymore. We've got clear strategic plans in place that are building services around two things really. Around the needs of families, but also about our needs to reduce demand into those services. So we've created an aged care service, which has got two parts to it, it's adolescent education service and an early years education service. And the purpose of those services is to make sure that children don't need to become looked after, and if they do, that they don't stay in the care system for longer than they need to. There's one example. We've integrated youth services as well, and we're also going to integrate our care leader service with the youth service in the near future, because that's part of our current consultation, which finishes on Friday of this week. We removing the line management, and keeping the line management in the integrated front door in prevention rather than in social care, because we need to make sure that we don't automatically assume that a child is a social worker when they could actually benefit from an early help service better. We've got a piece of work that's not yet finished around the model around early help or family support or prevention, whichever you want to describe it. That will be completed at the end of September, which will is actually bringing resources that we've got together, and we're sharing our ideas with that with our partners to see what we can create better integrated local delivery support services, particularly around the relationship with schools. And we are investing some of the resources that we've got into getting the shape of the capacity is right to the preventative services. So we've got a plan, we're implementing it, we're doing it incrementally, systematically, whilst at the same time responding to some more crises and events that happen, but we're not letting that become our day job, because actually that would be failing in our job if we're not providing that leadership.
On slide 3, which is the big averages of countries in the area of 2006, are you those children that they are with?
They're all our children protected by the World Council. There are a significant number of children living in Europe who are looked after from other parts of the country. That's not included.
That's not included in that.
They are all emerging.
Yeah, is there a correlation to those that are missing the child association that is
not there? Right, so any child who's looked after by a woman who goes missing gets a service. Or not. Because some of our children don't live before it. Is there a correlation between children who care about missing the CFC? Yes. That's why we have a rigorous response to those children. I mean, we offer each child, when they go missing, a return interview to find out where they've been, who they've been with, what they've been doing, why they've been missing, and particularly children who go missing regularly. So there's a system that sits in the front door that tracks and monitors all those missing episodes of people and shared information. Because we then try to develop intelligence then about why is that child always going to that particular address, or why is that child always found in this other individual. But the majority of missing episodes don't fit into that category. They are children who are not where they should be. They're not really missing, they're just not where they should be. And the issues are being missed for us. We want to get to them, so we care at the time. But they should have been able to We just make a distinction between children we're missing and worried about, and children we're missing, but we're not worried about, children we're worried about.
Okay, so there's two things. You've got all children and children
from out of Wales. But if they go missing, can you use all those reasons to ask about this? Yes, and if those children from out of Wales live because they're living here, we would treat them as if they were a child.
And what would they say? What would they say?
Over
200 at the moment, but it can go up to near 300. We have a provision in the borough to come in there
and with education.
That's
true. It's only now some of the students coming, but that at least the planet, the schools are refusing to educate the children from the North area.
I mean, I think it's a kind of a wider conversation, this, but I do think there's a real problem around how we provide care for and look after children in this country.
That was my point, is that is there a higher percentage of children from the outer area that are going missing and at risk of child exploitation?
Yeah.
Is that correlated with being transferred? Is it higher?
Well, We'll get back to you on that, but maybe my in my response to that is children who have come out of an area and go missing, generally you will bring them back. Because where they come, a local child who goes missing, they'll have people in them and they go missing with them, and often with the families to be honest with them, because their aunties or their uncles or
these are questions that have been raised in other areas.
I know,
just wondering whether it's
And there really is a problem about the importing of children from all over the country. That has got a particular problem in London. This region has got, the North West has got a very specific problem with London children as well. And it's all to do with the creation of the market.
That's what I was going to say, it's a market to be created and it's a market.
No, it's not. It's a very good scrutiny.
Perhaps that's something we could talk about. Some larger piece of work we can do. I've got an internet.
Thanks, Chair. Thanks for your presentation, Paul. I'm fairly new to this committee. And I think I'm going to carry on from Ian's question really regarding the recruitment of the social workers. You say this is the third thing to recruit, which is quite a high number. Going back 18 months ago when I was on the Combined Authority scrutiny, there was a discussion around whether or not all social workers, regardless of which borough they were in, were going to be paid the same rate of money, because the problem was that people were actually jumping from one borough to another or getting more money by being an agency worker. And as far as I'm aware, I don't believe that that's been resolved as yet. But I do think it's something that we probably should push, because it will make life easier for everybody else. I do have a second question as well, so we go to you both first. Okay. The other question is, do you have a view yet as to what good early intervention looks like?
I'm aware there was a conversation in the city region because I was on the other side of the water when that conversation was going on. And it's almost too sensible to get it wrong, isn't it? Because what happens, I think, is there's two elements to this. Is when the council's in difficulties, usually because it's failed an inspection, what it does is it tries to find a solution by throwing money at the problem. And part of that money trickles into the pockets of social workers, because we either pay them an enhanced agency rate, or we offer them more money to come and work for us. Neither of those two things are the solution in the medium or longer term to recruitment, retention, and development of social workers. We are part of the problem though, because we do offer more money than some of the boroughs in the city region. The borough I came from, second lowest paying borough in Cheshire and Merseyside for social workers. No recruitment, no retention problems. And that's because actually, if you create the right conditions for your practice, people want to work for you. The difference it makes in a pay packet might buy a pizza. It doesn't really change your life, but being in an organisation that helps you do the job properly makes your life a lot better. So, could you ever get six boroughs to agree to doing something like that? I think, from an officer point of view, we'd have a go at it, and from an elected member's point of view, you'd have a go at it until something goes wrong. So we've actually signed up to, all of us have signed up to a North West agreement around what we should pay agency workers, for example. And we get told regularly that we don't pay the going rate. But we pay the rate that we agreed to pay with our 23 colleagues in the North West. So someone's grasped us up, haven't they? Either that or we've been played by the agencies who are saying they pay £10 an hour, £5 an hour. So that was the easy one.
I wouldn't mind if you don't mind. It is based on what my daughter has said consistently, is it wasn't to do with money, it's to do with the quality of the way they manage in those areas. And I know that I would tell she's the first person. But I know that she has no wish to leave Nursing because she really likes Nursing. The other thing is that they travel, they'll go out from Merseyside, they go to Cheshire, or they'll go elsewhere, go to Lancashire. They don't mind traveling 40 minutes an hour at the start and end of the day. So it isn't, it wouldn't work.
Yeah, and there's probably something else I should say is that if you count on how many social workers are needed and how many there are, and then subtracted from that number of social workers who've gone to work for agencies, there's a big hole. So, what does a good early intervention service look like? I wouldn't venture to be able to answer that question just off the cuff, but there's some clear elements about it for me, and you can describe these about early intervention. Starts in universal services or in universal settings, isn't it? So, and actually, the best early intervention comes from the family looking after each other. So, part of the model needs to be to give families the right level of information and support to help them help themselves. So, we've done some work on this around the supporting families and enhancing futures approach based on restorative practice, which is about helping families find solutions to their own problems. The second element of it is that there's absolute clarity about who steps in to help a family when they need help. So that requires quite a lot of design, but it also requires a lot of collaboration between different agencies. Now we've got some ideas on this, when I say we, certainly Elizabeth's been doing a lot of thinking about this. And I think we could bring them to show you to see where we're going with that. You really need to have skilled people in early help services as well. People who are very good at engaging families, because actually the difference between the social work service and the early help service is you need consent for both, but you don't really need consent for social. People don't have to choose to use a social work service. They often get told they have to have one. Whereas early help requires insight from the family to be able to realise that the help that's been offered will help them. So there's a lot of skill requirement there as well. So part of the model is having the people who've got a range of different skills, including particularly good engagement skills with young people, children and young people. But the success of early help services is a very small social care service. I think someone was saying last week, you throw yourself on the fire last week, they say, their aim in life is to do yourself out of a job by making sure that we don't need any social care services. So one of the tests of a good early help service is it does actually reduce the amount of social work. Because if you have a social worker sort of someone, it's a great profession. It's lost the weight quite a lot of it. But children who receive social work services very often don't get very good outcomes. It's not the fault of social care, it's the fault of the fact that we're not being able to avoid being used for social work intervention. So it's something about making sure that the early health services avoid unnecessary contact access to social care. And we would call that, you know, officers who don't have any social care. It's much more about what is the necessary intervention.
Thank you both. Are we okay to move on to the data board? So we'll note the report and we'll also see if we can get the mandatory payment figures sent out as raised by Ian. So now we have the Rural Improvement Board data book, which is I think you have to, it says it's being introduced by Paul, but I did come work with someone the other day and hopefully she's going to give us a summary of what the data book is and the main headlines.
that, Chair. Basically, before I go up to give you some details about the data board, I thought it might be helpful for you to understand the difference of social care data. Because we have an awful lot of data, and actually you need to understand how to put that together to make it sensible and readable. It's not as straightforward as it sounds. So to get a coherent picture, you need to be able to interrogate the data we've given you. And the data we've given you actually is in different types of data. Some of it is demand data. Some of it is process efficiency data. And a little bit of it is outcome data. And some of it is around data that enables us to do our job. So I'm going to start with outcome data, because, you know, getting the outcomes right is constantly something we talk about in social care. And it's probably the most important thing we do. And I'm going to say it's actually one of the most difficult things to measure. We have very, very few outcome data. So I'm going to give you an example of a piece of outcome data. If Sue was sitting here from school, she would say, the qualifications that children are going to get this year are, and they're better than last year, and that was a real success, we've improved our outcomes for these children. If I said to you, this year, we've increased the number of children we've got looked after. Is that good or is that bad? Well, it could be, it depends, because actually, increasing the number, if that's right for the individual children, because we're going to actually change their lives for the better, they need to be looked after. If it's wrong for the individual children, it's bad. So that's the problem with social care data, because so little bit is actually outcome-based. You need to understand it to measure it. The few bits that actually are outcome-based are educational achievements for looked after children, so that's an outcome. Because everybody would agree that we want good education. Whether or not our care leavers are employment, education and training, because again, I don't think anyone could argue that that's not an outcome we want. And whether our care leavers actually live in good accommodation. But other than that, all of the other data that you're going to be presented with has that dilemma, which is you can read it one way and you can read it the other way. So if we're giving you all this data, what's the use of it? So let's try and make a little bit more sense of it. So I'm next going to talk about how we actually use demand data. And demand data, like outcome data, are the two things that we measure our success by benchmarking against others and looking at the trend. Now the demand data we've got, there's an awful lot of demand data in this pack. And what that means is numbers of things. How we count them. Numbers of contacts, numbers of referrals, numbers of assessments, number of children in need, number of children subject to a plan, number in proceedings, number looked after, and number of care leavers. That's presented in a chain view, and we can actually see that what it does when you look over the map is it follows the child's journey through our services. So it gives you an idea of the volume coming through. So the first thing we should say about demand data is before you can look at the social care demand data, you have to say, do I understand the population of our children out there? Because the things that are going to affect our demand coming in are things like poverty, changes out there in the social environment, things that are happening for families will potentially impact on that demand data. So at the moment, looking at our demand data, most of our demand data, really pleased to say, is in line with similar authorities. So numbers of contacts coming in, going across that section, is fairly well in line until we get to that moment, and we've already discussed it quite a bit, and it's looked after children. So when you're looking at demand data, if everything's out of line, what we need to be doing is asking questions and understanding why that demand data has changed or moved in the way it is. And I'll give you two examples in looking at this pack. One of the things that's happened in this pack, if you look, is it tells you that contacts have increased very, very significantly. Now, if that was actually genuinely the case, there would be lots and lots of questions to be asked as to why all of a sudden everybody's phoning social care because they perceive there's a problem. What we have done, and this is why data needs to come with an explanation, is in the month's data you are looking at, we changed our recording systems at the front door. And what that's meant, the things that we coded in different systems previously are now all being captured in the one system, the liquid logic system. And that's a really good news story, because what that means is we can track those cases properly, we can see which convert to referrals, we can see which day is contacts, and we can make sure that measure is consistent. So actually, what we need to do is come and explain to you those changes each time. But for that case, I can give you a good news story that that is positive. So again, in looking at this demand picture, is there anything else that's going to help you understand it and actually begin to question? Because I said it tells you the demand and the move through the system. What it also tells you is whether we change things. Because if there's not a need change out in the community, rural suddenly gets poorer, we expect more children in. If, you know, there's other circumstances happening out there that are making changes, we expect more children to come in. But if all those things are staying static and that demand profile is changing, the question I would expect you to ask the Russell officers is, where are your thresholds? So again, we had a nice example of that tonight, which was around children on child protection plans. Actually, we had a piece of demand data which said that we have very low numbers on children on child protection plans, and it's actually marked in the other data, but was green because it says lower number is better. But we've heard tonight that actually that has now increased, and we're very pleased about that. One of the reasons we're very pleased about that is, one, it's now in line with similar authorities, but two, what it means is that less children will be proceeding quite as quickly as they were before between being a child in need and being a child looked after. Because we did recognise that we had a high number of children that were retaining that child in need status, and that we were working with them, we were not doing as much as we should to prevent what was going to happen next. And that's also helped to cause an increase in the number of children looked after. So again, I hope that helps you understand a little bit about how you look at demand data and how you take that forward. The other data that you've got in there is around process efficiency. So what's the time limits of that? So you've got assessment data, are your assessments on time? We're asking, are the conferences on time? Again, this timeliness and efficiency data is really, really important because it gives us an idea of what we are doing in a timely way. But is always a book in social care data. If I said to you, what would you like us to do? We can do 100% of our assessments on time, but I can tell you now, not the quality of one of them. None of them are any good. They're not being done quickly, but they're not good. Or would you like us to do 50% of the assessments on time, and every single assessment, 100% assessment, even if they were a few days late, to be really good quality? So you can see the dilemma in looking at those, and I would be expecting you to ask questions about how we know what the quality is underneath that time and the status. So if we're raising our efficiency, are we getting the quality of what we're doing right, and are we driving that in the right way to make the difference for children? So that's a little understanding of how those bits of indicators come together. If we actually look at the data book which you've got for April, you can see that we highlighted a few things in the beginning. And what we've tried to do is actually put together a summary of those indicators and how we fit together, because we know that it's challenging to read our data in a way that makes sense. So we talked about contacts going up. We talked about the change in the number of children coming through and into the child protection plan. We've also talked about assessments. Now, as you can see, what we looked at in the April data book is what was happening around assessments, because this was one of the areas where we were not showing ourselves to be as timely as we should be. The number had dropped down. When we analysed that figure, we actually saw there were huge differences between different teams that were doing assessments. And actually, there is a backstory to it, because until recently, we looked after children who were not getting regular reassessments. And this was a big gap in the work that we were doing to drive the quality forward. Because you can imagine, if you're a child who comes into care at the age of 7, your needs at the age of 11 are going to be vastly different. And just because your worker might feel they know you, that is not as good as sitting down and doing a reassessment of your needs. So we were very clear with our looked after children team that all of our looked after children need a reassessment at least once a year or when anything changes. Some of our workers, being very energetic in this, actually opened a whole range of assessments there and then on Liquid Logic, even though they couldn't do all of their cases in one go, and it was going to take them a little time to work through it. But of course, having opened the assessment, it then ticked against the clock, didn't it? So what we then found is we had a high number of assessments that were open and when completed were out of time. I'm very pleased to say we've done work on that. We will see an improved picture coming through in the next month's data we're putting on it here. We've already increased our performance to around 87% in general from the April. And I can also say that the new service that we've talked about and we have put in place at the front door to make sure that things that from the front door are picked up effectively has currently, and touch wood in a bow in, 100% record of assessments on time. Now, I go back to, there will be times when that slips, because I would rather not be at 100% and ensure that they're all good quality, but I just wanted to reassure you that that picture was beginning to change and make a difference.
Can we just wait until someone finishes and then just say any question until we run the table?
In April we looked at the numbers levelling off, we looked after children and we saw the changes around the staffing. The only other thing that I would like to draw your attention to, because I think it's quite important I give you a heads up on it now, because it will change for next month, is in this data book we've included information about missing children. This is all missing children, it is not just looked after children, I want to make that clear to people. There has been a change in the way the police are collecting and delivering missing children information and data to us. Previously, up until the end of April, going on to the beginning of May, all children that were missing were actually categorised as either missing or absent. So we were looking at the missing children. The police have decided that they don't want to use the category absent anymore. They want to record all children as missing. Now that has an advantage of the fact that we get a full picture of any child who is missing, even if we know where they are, we're not worried about them, or anything like that. So we will get that data next time. So next time those numbers will go up slightly, but I can tell you within that group, it covers that, and I will be able to give you some information about that, how that breaks down. Numbers that looked after children within that and the amount of time in an average children are missing. I have to say, you know, in our most recent data set, the prize goes to the subject who managed to report a child missing within 2 minutes they were found. So I'm not absolutely sure how they even made the phone call on that one. There are some that are missing longer, but that just gives you the range of what we're looking at.
David?
Yes, I'm sorry for interrupting. When I was listening to you, I felt so excited. And then I looked at the HR pages. I thought to myself, oh, we've got the elephant in the room here. And it sort of leads me to be a little bit negative, which I never like to be. When you look at the vacancies, which are alarming, not only do you look at the vacancies, but you also look at the sickness monitoring. I don't know what the average national is for social workers. It's 6% isn't it for most people. But it doesn't really give a true indication possibly of what that figure is, but it's a large figure. So not only are you down with your actual capacity capability, but you're also up with your lack of those people being in attendance in the first place. And given what you were saying, which all sounded very buoyant and bubbly, if I may say, it's all academic if we haven't got the people to actually deliver it. So the question I've got is, if we're doing so well with the resources we have, do we need the resources we, you know where I'm going with this. It just makes me think there's something not quite right, and I'd appreciate clarification.
I mean, at the moment, we are working very, very, very hard to show you the resources we've got. Code 44 was actually me taking course of the emergency duty team, because I'm not called over tonight as well, so we are doing that. We are also using some of our resources that we don't want to use in the way that we're currently using them. So I'll give you an example of that. We put into our teams advanced practitioners, and that's a really key important post. And those posts should be helping us drive the quality agenda. Those posts shouldn't be case holding because they're working with the other social workers to develop practice. All of our advanced practitioners are case holding. So that's one way in which we're keeping some of this down. So there are real pressures in the system. Our sickness rate is high and it is reducing, and it does take time for the figures to come through. I can categorically tell you our major problem about sickness is not short-term absence, like running to around 6% or less. It's long-term absence, and I'm looking at Carly to confirm that we've been dealing with those people around long-term absence, and we are expecting it to drop. Nationally, it runs to about 11 days for social workers in return. So we're still high.
18.
It's 18 a month. I am expecting that to drop significantly.
Yeah, as Ryan described, because of the payroll dependency, this is not from 6 weeks out of date. This information will also for April, May, but we'll look at our details about February. I meet with colleagues from HR on a fortnightly basis to go through our top 20 and go through every single one, what we're doing. You know, what's the matter, are the managers applying sanctions consistently? You know, are they going through procedure, accelerating procedure, so we support each other to go block into some of those blockages really. I'm confident that actually we are reducing. I met on Friday, and we're perhaps corporately in the council, we have a pleasant high number of the top 10. Our first colleague is in on that sort of table. We've got 17th now. So we are reducing down, we are going down. I couldn't give you a figure now, but it's going to reach 15 days. But we will take that back to our team as well to discuss the detail. Also, how what Paul described in terms of training, that's being the manager training, the individuals who have attended are being spoken to by their managers about why they're not attending the house. And of course, a lot of the agencies, although not all of them, are covered by agency staff, so that's the other way we're filling that gap. But that, as we discussed before, brings with it the problem.
So,
thank you,
David. I'm going with this is that we've had in the past, and I think Moira knows this, is that we've had a situation whereby we haven't had consistent practices from an HR position. So for instance, people having a regular assessment review with their line manager, those having inconsistent reviews with their line manager, some being interested, some not. And I think what you're pointing at is that you're looking for consistency across all of it. So you're checking the managers, in effect, and I think that's what I was
Paul knows this. For me, the sign of actually getting to the root of what's going wrong here will be when you get to that point where you ask the question, so do you know when you're going? Sorry to be as brutal as that, but it was always about poor practice. It was always about poor first-time management practice. For me, some of those people will not want to change, and when we stop this, then they'll say, right, okay, you really grasp it by the throw down.
It's being brave. Just on the HR question as well is, we have got a dedicated head of HR working with the organisation. We've been here for, this is our second week, isn't it? A very experienced person. And they're precisely the issues that